It is certainly something. I just noticed that my spelling. Well, we still early. We still early. Oh, it's a few minutes early, but we still early. So, you know, I'll take it.
We got time for some house music there.
House music, get it, get it. Ah. My best to be actually paying attention to the theater chat. Okay. I'm seeing my sis. Look at that. Hello, people. Hello, my mentor is already on. Hey, Anika. I love you. My big sis Melissa's already on. Hey, sissy. I love you. I'm going to try to make sure I'm engaging in the chat today. We're gonna have to work on doing that, sis. We need to get some real good comments. I see you over there. All right, okay, okay. Let's get it. Don't hurt the people now. Don't hurt the people. Don't hurt the people. Sit down, sis. Sit down before we.
Why y'all want to be breaking
generational curses. Don't get me hyped up. I ain't been no place. Baby, I ain't did nothing.
Don't make me get in my house back, honey.
Don't get me started.
Don't forget your girl. For real.
I ain't been nowhere. So don't start. Do not start. I can't with you. Sit down, damn it. I cannot. It's almost 8. Listen, don't start doing the mating call now. Singing all them hips and whatnot. You like Mother Earth. Let's go. Come on in and join us. We trying to start off and put some good vibes in the air because today's talk is not going to be so much fun like some of our other talks before. We're going to get a little nitty gritty today. Yeah, I don't have my wine. I probably should get my wine. Should probably have some, but welcome.
This is the blood of Jesus. Mind your business.
Not the blood. I came with you today. Welcome, everybody. Thank you guys for joining us on time.
Hello.
We on time. You know, I like this streak we got going. We doing our part.
We trying it.
Hey, we got
it. I bet you was Jelani that made one talking about some y'all on time.
Yo-Yo on here. She on here. I see you. Hey, boo. Yes, we started on time. Thank you guys for joining us. As we start breaking more generational curses. Today, we're going to really talk. And we're going to really talk about toxic femininity. Now, I know we're going to ruffle some feathers, but it's very important that we be honest about this topic and we start talking about this topic because, you know, most of us are pretty much the primary caregivers of our children and everything else. And if we're going to talk about breaking generational curses, we definitely have to break this one. We do have some toxic mothers. We have some toxic sisters. We have some toxic aunties. We got some toxicity and feminine hood. So, you ready?
I'm gonna let you lead off on this one, cause
what? You putting it all off on me.
I mean, I'm not putting it all off on you. However, I have a lot to say on this topic because I used to be player president of the Bitter Bitch Society, okay, aka leader of the toxic femininity family, if you will.
But we all grow and change. So that's a testament to your growth.
We all don't. Kawana did. So Kawana can attest to her own growth.
Some of us.
Thank you. However, I, as a mental health counselor, and just as a human being and a healer walking down the street in sheer observation alone, mm-hmm. I am borne witness to, I have been victim of what I would like to consider toxic femininity. Now, can I give that a concrete definition? No. What I can attempt to do, myself and my sister, homie, best friend, family, loved one, Sante will attempt to do tonight is not only put a face to what toxic femininity may look like or how it may present, but we shall do what Mother Iyanla Van Zandt likes to say, calling a thing a thing. Because we as women tend to feel that because a prominent toxicity in society is patriarchy, AKA toxic masculinity, that there is not an opposite end of the spectrum in kind. AKA we act as if our shit don't stink sometimes.
We do.
But the men's just smell all the time. Yeah, we're not gonna do that. We can. Because a lot of the reason that a lot of their shit stinks as men is because of what you put on them as a woman, mm-hmm. as their mother. But see, I shaved my arm so I could stretch real good this weekend. Cause we're gonna talk.
You're gonna stretch it out because
we're gonna talk about that.
We gonna ruffle some feathers. And again, the disclaimer is if it does not apply, then let it fly. If we're not talking about you, then we're not talking to you.
And if you would like to address it, keep it cute.
Keep it cute. Because period. We're not doing this to look down on anybody. Let's start there. Because first and foremost, I have been guilty of some toxic femininity in my own, on my own accord. And coming to the realization and how I was contributing to that was a key factor in just me wanting to address it. Because even as someone that didn't think that she was contributing to it, having to own that I am contributing to it in some way, it's a very humbling experience, to say the least. It's not an easy task to do. You hurt your own feelings when you start telling yourself the truth. So just know that anything that I'm speaking on today, I'm speaking from a place of experience.
Personal experience. Woo!
I'm not here to judge. I'm not here to look down on. I'm hoping to plant the seed so that moving forward, all of us can be aware. Because ultimately what I want is for us all to be able to be on one accord. Us with men with us. And in order for that to happen, we got to start owning our own shit. And we don't do that as women. It's always them. But when you're pointing, there's three back at you. There's always three at you. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to hold ourselves accountable today. I'm going to be trying my best to watch the comments. I know that I fall short on that sometimes, so bear with me, be patient. Sometimes when we getting in that convo, when it's getting thick, it's hard to look down. So yeah. I'm gonna try to make sure I'm addressing the comments today, but bear with me as I attempt that. So where do we start?
<Deep breath. laughs> So just for the sake of being accountable, I will start with my own mm-hmm. story. So what had happened was I, at one point, and in some cases still am, was just really, 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 really just not in a good space when it came to men. I will specify African-American men only because while I do not discriminate, I do have my personal bias. My personal bias and preference are African-American men. That said, I have not always had the best experiences with them. In my own personal defense, some, not all, but some men just who are who they are. And some of them just ain't. We ain't gonna say that word, but y'all know what I'm about to say. Some men just ain't.
Some men just
for whatever reason. And we will talk about that next week.
We gonna talk about that next week.
However, comma, ultimately what I learned was it ain't always just them. Mm. And it ain't always just them that gravitated to you for no reason. They wasn't that damn bored, because I told y'all I deal in energy. Okay. One of my cousins in Gonzi pulled me to the side at an event at this place called the Culture Connection on 71st and Wentworth. Mm-hmm. And she watched my Facebook live for my Facebook page for a while, right? And she pulled me to the side, Jean, on my mama. She looked me dead in my face and was like, stop saying black men ain't shit on Facebook. And I'm talking about shook me, Joe. I was like, huh? She was like, stop saying that. Mm-hmm. One, because it's not a fair generalization. And two, mm-hmm. you're projecting based on your own. And that's not fair. Please stop saying that. Now, initially, I felt the way.
I'm sure, because I know you.
But when I say initially, I meant for all of like 15 seconds. Mm-hmm. Because what ended up happening was, because it was my cousin, somebody I actually
considered the source.
Who came to me and pulled me to the side, not blasted me.
In front of everybody.
Nah, pull me to the side, because I love you. Stop doing that. That's not a good look for you. And if you did want a good man, who you think you're going to attract? Talking like that. And I was salty for about 15 seconds, so that thing sat in my spirit. And I was in, and when I say it shook me. Now, not in every case, but in my case, I had to stop and consider the source of why these niggas wasn't shit. Because if they're a mirror of what I'm attracting, then guess what? But you ain't shit neither.
We talked about that before, about paying attention to the common denominator.
And it was me.
Yeah.
Again, it's not to say that those men didn't have their stuff, but what was I doing? What characteristics was I giving off? What energy was I putting in the universe, in the air, to even have them penetrate my world like that? See, that doesn't happen to me that much anymore. I'm not saying it doesn't at all.
Right.
But very rarely do I have a man approach me in a very disrespectful manner, or a female approach, anybody approach me in a very disrespectful manner now. Because I had to sit that check. Maybe. But the reason why is because I had to sit and look in the mirror and be like, what are you doing? What are you saying? How are you projecting your shit to attract that shit? Because if they ain't shit and you attracted to them and attracting them, you ain't shit neither. So let's talk about it, bitch. Let's really talk about it.
So this topic in particular is very, very, very dear and dear to me. As I've stated before, some things kind of really hit ahead for me in motherhood, where I had to realize that I may be the common denominator in a lot of things, right? And it wasn't even just as a mother, but also realizing and owning where I can be better as a wife. Now, most of you know me. I take a lot of pride in being a wife. I'm not a perfect wife. I never put claim to be a perfect wife. But one thing is damn sure.
Yes, she is.
I'm so not. So not. I live with a whole man that might argue with you on that. I know I have my flaws, and I know I have my baggage. And because my baggage doesn't look like some of the other baggage that I've learned about, that I've seen, that I've experienced through other women. You know, you kind of get to a place where you're just like, well, I'm different. So, you know, I'm here. And I had to bring myself back down. So I'm just going to be honest about that. So that was one of the ways where I had to own my shit and realize that, you know what, I do have some toxic femininity. Now, coming from a long line of strong Black women that have had to do it alone in some ways, one way or another, my mother especially always wanted me to be a strong Black woman. Like, baby, you're going to have to be strong, because the world out here for you, it ain't going to be sweet. And while, you know, they say Black men have it the worst, it's really Black women. And here is why. So my mother was very, very, very much on me about being able to be strong, stand still, be that fortress of steel. So I operated on that to a point where at times I was very cold. Not because I didn't have a caring bone, not because I didn't care about my husband, but it was just like, yeah, I'm not like, if I got to get through this, and this, I need you to be able to get through this, and this. Like, come on now. Like, you know, I got to do this and I got to do that and I have to do this and I have to do it all while falling apart. But nobody around me may know that I'm falling apart. So I don't want to hear about you having a bad day. Like, oh, you know what I went through today? Do you know what I had to do today? You know what it's like to be me right now? And I had to finesse that. And I had to learn that that was being toxic. But we never think about that. We never think about it from that place of that this is being like, I am so woman and I'm so woman and I'm doing all of this. So we don't realize that how that affects us in relationships. We don't realize how that affects us in our daughters. So I had to be mindful of that because then I wanted my child to be like that. One of the most humbling things was having to realize, like, I'm not making a space for my baby to be a human being because I'm so worried about her being this functioning adult woman, because that's what I am. We all broken. We are, ain't nobody here unbroken. We all got some scars, some battle wounds, some something, right? Like, we all got some something. Some of us are just more functioning than others. Just like you may know someone that can drink all night, but they gonna get up and go to work the next
day. I dated somebody. We triggered them all.
We're not going there. We not putting nobody out here. That's not
what one of the was. Reasons why I was so toxic in my femininity for a very long periodically time.
Right. But it's true. And I had to recognize that. And then it took for me to start doing some reflection. Like, why am I expecting for her to be inhuman and then get mad if I'm treated inhumanly? Like, if someone is like, you know, think that they can poke me or I can just take all of this and all of that and I'm gonna be okay. But am I in some way contributing to that? Am I making them feel like I'm inhuman? Because they certainly treat me like that. And I had to think about that even in my marriage because I operated on that structure sometimes. And that is very toxic. It's nothing wrong with being strong. Look,
you know, honestly, okay, so let's, if we're going to talk about it, let's really talk about it. So again, those of you all who know me know that I had a very horrible disease called ovarian cancer, right? So let's be very, very, very transparent and clear. That was one of several roots and foundations for and of my toxic femininity. And here's why. Number one, when you go through something like that and you got to watch people get stuff that you wanted and you busted your ass for and you earned, AKA, you got to watch your friends get married and watch your friends get their degrees and watch your friends have kids and watch your friends have family. Yeah, you get real salty about shit like that. And that happened to me and I carried that around a lot. I carried around a lot of guilt because I felt like there was a lot of things I could have done better, a lot of things I could have done differently, a lot of situations I could have handled if I hadn't done this, if I didn't move over here. And then when I came back home, 6 people died on me in the first 6 months that I was here. My grandmother included, the day after my 25th birthday. So not only am I trying to recover from a disease that I never really even processed in the first place, 6 people died. 3 of those people include Jennifer Hudson's family. Like, I was on the block when all that happened. So I'm dealing with PTSD. And anxiety and insomnia. I'm dealing with all of this. I don't have anybody I can talk to. I don't have anybody that can relate. And I'm just popping at everybody. When I say popping, y'all, I mean cursing people out, biting people's head off for no reason. They would be asking me basic questions and I'm just ripping their whole jugular out. Why? Because I was angry. And it wasn't for any other reason than I was angry because this disease, in my mind, this disease fucked my life up. And I don't know how to handle that. And that manifested in me not handling shit very well.
Can I cut in just for a brief second?
Because yeah. I
think it's really important that when we're talking about certain things, especially as mental health professionals, right, that we need to really call that thing what it is. It wasn't anger. It was trauma.
That too.
You had trauma. And you were
trying. And it was, well, nope, let's be real. Let's be real, real, real technical about it. Complex trauma. Mm-hmm. So here's the difference between trauma and complex trauma, ladies, because let's be clear, trauma is the root foundation of all toxic femininity, from how you raise your children to how you operated your relationships, whether platonic or intimate, what have you, how you operated your professional life. It is the root. Trauma is the root cause of all of it.
Stop, because that is very important. And we need to talk about that, because I don't want people to think that in this conversation, we're condemning you.
Or saying
they're less of a woman. We need you to understand where that place and where place you're operating from. And where you're operating from is trauma. And so, some of it ain't going to be yours. Some of your trauma is generational.
Passed down from your mama. And I'm going to get into that because y'all know.
From your grandmama. And so on. And carry on.
Regular trauma. Mm-hmm. Or singular trauma, however you want to call it, that's maybe an isolated incident. Like maybe you witnessed a drive-by, or maybe you were a victim of domestic violence, or you grew up in an abusive household, or you saw your daddy smack your mom, like, or y'all could see them get into a big fight, or like kids from Columbine, they have PTSD, regular trauma, right? So complex trauma is when you have multiple traumas that happen to you back to back to back to back to back. So what happens when you have complex trauma is you get so used to operating in that trauma that you operate like fight or flight is the normal response to everything.
Everything.
And it's not.
And it's not. And not only is it not the thing to do, you running away from it only makes the situation worse. Then you're more than likely going to experience, or honestly, you can traumatize somebody else.
Hello.
You running from.
So wonder why you can't keep no man.
It's just a gift that keeps on giving.
Why, like, wonder why you can't keep no friends.
Why you can't keep no friends. So you're going and, you know, that's where the whole birth of the saying of hurt people, that is what that came from. That is the why that is the case, because as you operate in your trauma, you're now traumatizing people who are going to go out and traumatize people. And for me, that was probably one of the most important things for me, was like, I got two whole human beings that I'm going to send out into the world, and they're going to come into contact with other people, and how they treat others is going to be a direct reflection of what they learned in these walls, especially what they learned from me, because I am the primary caregiver.
Specifically, what you fed them emotionally, mentally, spiritually, and in their case, externally, when you were pregnant with them.
When you were
ladies, pregnant? Let's talk about this real quick. Okay.
Okay. Go ahead. Get into it, sis. I'm gonna let you have this one. I'm gonna let you have it. But I'm gonna get to that too, as someone that truly understands
in real life, because I'm real life from a clinical and a healing perspective.
Because your baby feels everything. You are closest,
let's be clear. The closest I've ever been to being pregnant is the tumor that the doctors took out of me before I got diagnosed with ovarian cancer. So I don't know nothing about that. Mm-hmm. Technically, I had a miscarriage. If you want to call a thing, that tumor was a miscarriage that mutated into a tumor. So I don't know what it is to carry a child to full term. But I know what it is clinically to be pregnant with a kid and you fighting with your baby daddy because he's cheating with the next one that you knew he was cheating with before you got pregnant with that kid. Huh? Who business did I just tell? Or you pregnant with the kid and although you happy you pregnant, you probably really didn't want to get pregnant right now because it's bad timing and y'all finances is bad and you're stressing about this and your job is short over here. So guess who else stressing out too?
That baby.
Wondering why that baby kicking, screaming, moving, shaking, doing the chicken head in your belly at 3 o'clock in the morning while you can't sleep. It's because you can't sleep. What's on your mind that you feeding that baby? You know what I mean? Like, let's talk about, you know, you worrying about certain things instead of just feeding it to the fact that you happy you bringing this life into this world. Or let's talk about the fact that you done got pregnant by somebody who probably didn't want the kid, but you kept it thinking that you was going to keep the man. Oh, who business am I telling right now?
You telling people business. We going to probably
get. So you got pregnant by this dude thinking that was going to make the relationship better. And then when it's not getting better, you stressing about that and you mad at yourself about that. And now you regretting the fact that you got pregnant in the first place and you think that baby can't feel a hit at. So when that baby comes into this world, distressed, crying, screaming, yelling, fussing, and you can't soothe him, you wonder why. Probably because that's what you was doing.
And I can speak from personal experience on so many things because neither of my children were formally planned. Noriah especially came at a time where I was almost done with undergrad. I was almost, you know, finish, and boom, it was like, I'm pregnant. Robert way down in Carbondale. I'm up here. It's like, what we gonna do? You know, this is like the worst time ever. And then, you know, going to the doctor, boom, find out that it was supposed to be twins. And, you know, the other baby has disappeared. I had what was called disappearing twin syndrome or vanishing twin syndrome. And then finding out, you know, I almost miscarried the entire pregnancy. So I spent most of my pregnancy on bed rest with Noriah. So what I have to do, I had to get out of school because it was like, you know, I got to choose between my child's life and, you know, I can go back to school. But the stress and all of that, when having certain things happen, as a parent, you know, my baby has anxiety and just kind of wondering like, well, could this have been from when I was pregnant? And it's just surfacing now. Like, is it just surfacing now? For Kyren, I tried to be the most happiest pregnant lady, but I was also in school getting my master's. So I'm stressed now about school. I'm staying up all hours of the night trying to, you know, keep it together and make sure I pass these classes. Then boom, he comes a whole month early, you know, so now I got him here a whole lot sooner than I expected. And then he had colic for 6 months. And it was like, okay, where does this come from? Like, what did I do something? So we may not be aware, and I'm not saying that to say, like, if you are experiencing these things with your children, it was your fault. Because
no, that's not what anybody this is.
To think that at all. That's not what this is. I just want people to understand how when you're sharing your body with a whole human being, you're essentially bringing life. They feel everything. Every elevated heartbeat that I experienced, they experienced that. Every time I was tired, they experienced that. If I was worried,
Robert Falk,
that, you know, you said what?
If you and Robert had like a verbal,
if we had a disagreement, they experienced that. Fortunately, he was very supportive both times that I was pregnant. Super supportive both times. It was, you know, we gonna figure it out, we gonna get through it. But I could not have imagined not having that support in that time because it was just so much. It was just so much other things to worry about. So if you're going through that, if you're experiencing that, I know that it's a lot easier said than done because, again, I'm speaking from a place of being there. I know what it's like. I know how hard it is, but you're going to have to try as best you can, sis, to not pass that down because now that's in your baby's DNA. That's in your baby's DNA. All of that trauma, all of that pain, all of that anguish, and they don't deserve to start out like that.
And even if they do, at some point they're going to either want or need to unlearn that. And when things are genetic, you basically at that point almost need an exorcist to get that stuff up on up out of you in real life. And that's not, that's not a spiritual journey that you want to play with. Take it from me. Because when I say I've been there, I mean I've been there. I mean I've been to a Santeria priest, okay? I mean I've had Reiki done several times on me. I mean I sat in therapy for a full year in grad school and cried in a way that I have never cried before. And the reason why is because all of that trauma from my diagnosis, all of that trauma from those 6 deaths, all of that trauma from me numbing all of from drinking and smoking, all of that trauma from possible being manic because bipolar disorder type 1 runs in my family. Yeah, all that hit me hard. And I had nobody to talk to, and I finally had someone with an unbiased opinion helping me process my feelings. But when I tell you, toxic femininity doesn't always look like the hood rats fighting on the street over a dude, because that is very toxic, but it doesn't always look explicit like that.
It don't always look like you ain't shit, you ain't gonna never be shit. It don't always look like that. Sometimes toxic femininity is very subtle.
Yep.
And it's so subtle that you don't even realize that you're operating in it, that you're moving in that space. So it's like super important to be aware of the fact that you too, sis, can be toxic. And really where it's coming from is that unresolved trauma. And I don't want to get away from talking about that. It's super important that we start thinking about like your own traumas. You know, I've been trying to post some of the things. For one thing, I posted earlier today was about healing from your trauma if you have sons. That's super important. I had some trauma I had to heal from before I could love on my son in the way he deserved to be loved on. I had to do some self-reflection on that trauma before I could love on my son the way that I was supposed to. I had to forgive so that I can love on my child wholeheartedly and not look for him to fulfill that void. Will it back? Go ahead, sis.
Say that forgiveness part one more time because I don't think they heard you in the back. Because I'm gonna talk about that too.
Forgiveness is for the forgiver. And I think that a lot of people forget or don't understand what forgiveness means and how it operates. And not even just for the person that's giving the forgiveness, but for the person that wants to receive it. So what forgiveness is for, it's for you. Because as long as you don't forgive, you carrying around all of that anger, that grudge, and it's toxic and it eats away at your spirit. So you forgive for you. It's a very selfish act. It's for you. However, just because you forgive, you don't have to accept. And I think that that's a difference that people don't understand. I could forgive you for what you did. I can let it go and say, you know what, wish you well, but I don't have to accept your dysfunction in that forgiveness. I don't have to accept a relationship or an opportunity for you to need my forgiveness again. And that's okay to draw that line on that. But you want to forgive, because when you don't, what Erica say, bag, I can't sing. You sing it back, bag lady. Don't. But you get the
bag
point.
Lady.
There you go.
Don't hurt your back. Dragging all them bags like that.
That's my boo, yeah.
And that's nobody ever told you. All you must hold on to is you, is you, is you.
See, that's why you sang at my wedding.
So let me tell you, listen, so I told y'all last week that I had, I don't know if it was last week or maybe a couple of weeks ago, I had a homegirl I was cool with. It's like, I felt like she was my soulmate. She stole some money from me. I promise you every day for a long time. It was on site every time I see you home, busting your ass, bitch. So, while my frustration and my anger was warranted and it was valid because my trust had been broken, the toxic femininity in me lied in the fact that I held on to every time I want to, every time I see you, ho. every time I see you, bitch. I'm talking about, I don't care if it's in the church, bitch. If you at the altar, I'm snatching you by your edges to the back of that bitch. Okay? Listen. I had to get to a space where I had to forgive her. Mm-hmm. Not because I wanted to, because I really didn't, and I still don't. Let's be clear. I still, when I see her, I'm a roll my eyes real hard. I don't want to, it's not going to be on sight. But that took work. Because if you're walking around with that anger, who is it helping? That girl don't give a fuck that I'm still mad about her. She had my money. She did what she needed to do when she didn't go around with her life.
If she was living, she probably was out and made it rain somewhere with your money, not thinking about you. So
and you period. And she had done it to multiple people. And I found that out later because I didn't know in the moment. But the bottom line is I'm walking around mad at this girl. And yes, it's justified, but I'm holding on to it for what?
Because
she got ran out of town anyway, still doing the same dumb stuff, and then got ran back in town for doing the same goofy shit out of town. So karma kicked on her ass way more than I ever could if I saw her and beat her ass on sight.
You gotta let it do what it
I
is.
Had to let that go.
Yep.
Now again, let's be clear, the young lady who I said if I had to have a conversation with her, would I let her talk? Yeah, but I won't have shit to say to her. That's who I'm talking about. We can have a conversation. But that's because I had to move beyond my own toxic femininity of wanting to beat her ass every time I see her. Everything doesn't have to be a fight. Because I had to come to my higher self and realize that there's trauma and know, because I know that there's trauma in her background.
There's trauma in her.
And her trauma dictated a lot of the moves that she made in her life and a lot of the ways that she operated and presented with and to me.
Here's the thing, though, because I want to address that. Now, just because you may recognize what place she came from and why she did her stuff, it does not
necessarily... That don't mean it's okay.
It's not okay.
Bitch, it's still on site. Right. No, for real, but no.
Please don't.
It's not like that for me anymore, but...
Okay, good, because, I mean, I might have to do something strange for some change to get you out, and I don't... You know,
and let me be clear, and in real life, I put that on my own grave, and I'm not dead yet, you would have.
Please don't.
Because I was that angry with her, and let's be clear, because my trauma was, you broke my trust. You are my friend. Mm-hmm. I considered you my sister. And my standard for, like we talked about last week, my standard for friendship is this freaking high. And I've already had somebody from Fisk dragging my name through the mud and breaking my trust in a different way, but the same way you are now. So now you done triggered me because you doing some stuff that somebody else did. So now I don't want to beat your ass the way I wanted to beat her ass. And even when she got mad, even when that girl did something to me, I got mad at her, wanted to beat her ass the way I probably wanted to beat somebody else's ass in the past. Now I can't keep doing it that way. Because who was it benefiting? None of those women have thought about me. Maybe one, because she inboxed me later and was like, I miss our friendship. I know it don't mean anything to you. But okay, I'm glad you recognize that, because it doesn't.
And she don't miss your friendship. She missed what she got from it.
Whatever that was, I'm not moved. I let her know. And I hated to be very bland with her, but I had to be mature and just let her know, while I appreciate that, I'm extremely indifferent about whatever you feel about me. Because the bottom line is, for you to be my friend in the way you played me that way, now I don't appreciate that.
Yeah,
I really don't. And I love you. I appreciate you reaching out to me, but I'm very indifferent about what you had to say. And I, whatever, take care. And I never heard from her again. And I'm okay with that. I hope she's well. I don't wish no harm on her anymore. But sometimes you just got to let your anger for some people go, and that includes your baby daddy. So let's talk about it.
That includes your baby daddy. That includes your mom.
Your daddy, daddy.
Daddy, your daddy, daddy. It includes all of the above. Because if you operate on that system, at the end of the day, all you're doing is hurting you and whoever Period. Loves you.
Period.
Whoever around you cares for you. Whoever around you is reaching out for you. You're going to pass that trauma down. You're going to go out and injure other people, and that's not what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be healing, And I know we talk about that healing process a lot because I really need people to understand the healing process is not beautiful. You don't have this one moment in therapy and come out and the sun is shining on you and you just kind of standing there feeling free and born again. Like,
amen. I was crying. I was crying in therapy 3 weeks ago when I said, motherfuckers, I'm crying. Yeah. Do you hear me?
Yeah.
And y'all be seeing me on Facebook giving all the spiritual, all the healing. I was in therapy looking like a little hoe who had just got beat up because she missed her payment with her pimp, crying. Do you hear me? Ugly crying.
Ugly.
And then just this recently, I was fine. That it's not easy. Like, it's not easy to sometimes get in the mirror and face it. It's not easy to be a real woman and actually have somebody and have somebody tell you something and you be like, you know what? It's not easy to humble yourself and realize that your shit stinks sometimes. Trust me.
Ooh,
and I die to myself every single day. Every single day, I die to my own flesh. Why? Because I don't want nobody else to have to humble me about nothing.
So I want to share a very humbling experience for me. Was having my child tell me at one point, like, I need to tell you something, but I don't want to say it in a way because I don't want you to feel some sort of way about it because I think you are a wonderful mother. So already your antennas is up. You like, wait a minute, I want to be a wonderful mother. Am I not? Like, but what do you got to tell me? Like, tell me. And having her tell me, you know, sometimes I just feel sorry for you because she just seems so angry all the time.
No, she did it.
She did. You just seem so angry and like you're carrying around so much stuff. You do so much all the time. And I'm afraid to grow up because if that's what it looks like for being a woman,
damn.
I don't know if I want to have to do that. So I just want to be a kid forever because it just is not a good being a grown up.
Yikes.
So you want to talk about picking your face up off the ground? Do you want to talk about gut punching you? Like,
ooh, no, because my heart hurts right now. Shit.
Listen, clutch pearls, clutch pearls. And
I ain't even my kid. Jesus. Listen,
so, you know, that was a very, very humbling experience for me because then I had to think about that. I'm like, now she'll also tell you her mother is hardworking. She'll also tell you my mom is so smart. My mom is fun. She's funny. She'll say all of these other great things about me. But to know that she felt sorry for me because I'm always doing so much and I'm always responsible for this and I'm running around, I'm tired, I'm angry, I'm not getting enough sleep. I don't go out and have no fun because I'm so focused on this, and this. It was like, I thought I was setting a really good example for her, for the type of woman she should grow up and be. And so I wanted to hear more. I allowed her to tell me the truth. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I cried my whole ass in the shower.
And I can imagine.
And cried in the shower, honey. Because it was like, all that I do, I'm trying to make sure that I'm this great mom. I go above and beyond to make them happy. But see, I wasn't realizing that I was angry. I was angry about some stuff.
So let's talk about being angry. And I don't want to just talk about us being angry at the baby daddies. I want to talk about being angry at the ex-mens, whether it be your dad, your baby daddy, or that one that got away or that one that should stay far the fuck away, whatever the case is. So here's what happened with me. And here's why I realized I was operating in a lot of toxic femininity. There was someone who I was dating for a while. Long story short, I found out I was the essentially the other woman. Let me be extremely transparent. I knew before we started dealing with each other that we should not have. Like, I'm gifted in that. Like, first of all, I'm a woman. So we all, ladies, I'm talking to y'all when I tell this story. It's just certain stuff that we know
That you ignore.
That we ignore.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And that's a lot of the root of our toxic femininity that we carry into our relationships with baby daddies, with men, with who we're dating, who we marry, whatever. Long story short, yeah, I didn't talk to Buddy for like 6 or 7 years for obvious reasons. I talked to him recently this year. Not by choice, not because I reached out to him, it's because he reached out to me apologizing, which I had to humbly accept because I wasn't trying to hit. He was another one. Nigga, every time I see you, my nigga, I'm gonna rock at your head.
On sight.
Because I don't want to drag like that, but I will just say that there were certain things about that situation that were just really unhealthy. We were trauma bonding in several different nasty, disgusting ways, and trauma bonding is a whole other story. Now
we're gonna talk about that.
Yeah, because we'd be here all night talking about trauma bonding, which is the root of a lot of y'all's toxic femininity as well.
Boom. Yes, indeed.
So we didn't have a conversation per se, but what he did do was apologize to me for his behavior.
Right.
And it seemed genuine, whether it was or not, I can't say, but I did accept it. What I did also admit to and acknowledge and had to swallow and accept is I had to tell him, hey man, listen, first of all, I knew that I shouldn't have been involved with you in the first goddamn place, because when I hugged you, I felt like I had to throw up. Ladies, we be knowing certain things when it comes to men, when it comes to jobs, when it comes to family, when it comes to our goddamn kids, we be knowing.
When it comes to just about anything.
Somebody, something that whoever, whatever it is you believe, we be knowing.
Be knowing.
This man was making me sick. When I say sick, when he touched me, I was throwing up. It was physically manifesting into me being ill whenever he touched me. I ignored that shit for 3 years. I'm like, bro, I knew before we had sex that we weren't supposed to do that. We were supposed to just be friends and spiritual, mental. We were supposed to just be that. And that I knew, which was the root of my anger with him and a lot of men after him. So much so that my current partner right now gave his ass hell for 3 years because of it. Straight hell. And if you watching, I love you, my honey bunny. And I know we've had this conversation, but yet 3 years straight gave him complete and utter hell. And it was because I was waiting on him to drop me the way the other dude did.
Yeah.
And that wasn't fair. And it wasn't fair to my partner. And if he's watching, I apologize. I know we've had this conversation. I'm treat you special real nice next time I see you, okay?
I mean, but the bottom line, you share with the people to teach the people.
Because in real life, this stuff is real. I let a whole situation that wasn't a real situation, it was a trauma bonding situation that should not have been, and I knew. Listen to me, ladies. Hear me when I say this, because some of y'all be knowing.
And ignore.
And you choose to ignore. And then not only do you do that, when it's time for you to acknowledge that it was you that fucked up, you don't want to eat that. No, baby. Eat the cake, anime.
I'm going to need you to behave. I said behave.
Eat the cake, anime.
I said behave.
Sometimes you got to look in the mirror and eat that, bro.
You got to. It's the only way. If you can't look in the mirror and eat that and own that, you're doomed to repeat that. You're gonna repeat it over and over again, because ignorance is bliss, but you gotta get tired of that. At some point, you just
gotta. I got tired. I got muffin tired.
And method tired. I hear you. And I want us to be aware of that and just recognizing where we kind of cause and inflict some of our own pain. He probably wasn't right, he probably wasn't shit, and he probably did this and that and the third wrong, but you also chose, even as
a sexual assault advocate, and I know this is really sticky for you.
It's very well. I want to be clear, because the two are not together. Right. Right. I'm talking about when you're, when you are consenting.
Yeah, right, to right, right.
Something toxic.
That you know.
That you know
not for you, that you know may not benefit you on the back end.
And totally separate from being in a DV situation, because the two are not the same.
Right.
And I don't want people to be like, well, you know, if you in that situation and this person is harming you, then you choosing. No, because
no, that's a whole different thing. Because that's Stockholm syndrome, and that's a whole other conversation that we can get into later.
That's a whole other conversation. Right, but as a sexual assault advocate, DV advocate, I am not saying that. That is not what I am saying. I want to be very clear on that. I'm right. talking about when you make a conscious decision to ignore.
Like ladies, the makeup to break up relationships, let's talk about it. Why are we doing that? You say this nigga don't do, he don't say, he don't, and I would say fellas too, but we talking to the ladies tonight, so I'm focusing on y'all. Let's be clear, the reason why we're focusing on y'all, because we talking about femininity. Fellas, we gonna get on y'all ass next week, but until we do, ladies, go and get that ice pack, because I'm about to put that heat on your neck, okay? And I love y'all. When I say I love y'all and I love us for real. I love us for real. But when I tell y'all, I'm talking from personal experience and I'm talking from my ragged ass closet that got a 17,000 skeletons in it, okay? So I'm not judging nobody on here.
Not one soul. Not
but anything. In real life, sometimes we know. And a lot of times we ignore. And a lot of times we'll just continue to do, say, be, think, and feel according to what's comfortable for us. Like the whole...
Hold on. I'm sorry. Because my mentor said something, and this is super important, and I need to address it because this is the other part of that. My mentor, Anika, said, we need to stop thinking someone will change for us or we can change them. Ladies. I know I'm supposed to be the feather. Let me get close on the mic.
Please get them, because you know if I do, I'm going to have some feelings for real, for real.
Can you hear me?
Because this foot, baby, this size 11.
Listen, I see you. But I need to stress this. Because out of so many things that I hear my sister saying, this hurts me one of the most ways. This hurts me deep. Because you ain't gonna change them, sis.
I don't care
how fly you are. I don't care that you got that fabulous job in the car to match, that you got 11 degrees, that
I don't care if you bought 15 yoni eggs, it can fit all of them in your pussy.
It does not matter.
It matters not.
Zero.
He will change when he wants to and when he is ready. Not when because you are the driving. You can be a motivating factor. You can be a catalyst. You are not the reason. Get over yourself and let that nigga go.
And that story that you heard from a long time about your vagina being powerful and, you know, the power of the V is going to change somebody. It is not. He only changes when he sees fit, when he wants to change. And if you recognize that he's not willing to change,
why are you still there?
You ain't gonna do it.
Why are you still there? What's the hope?
Why are you still there? Let it go and move on. Because now what you're doing is you let him stand in the way of that other person that may give you what you need, but you so focused.
And let's also talk about toxic femininity in the form of when your real friends try to have a conversation with you about that. Ooh. Yes. And let's be clear, it's not just about that. When your real friends want to have a conversation about your stinking ass.
See, I'm that friend. All my friends, I don't know who.
Let's talk about it, ladies.
On here that's watching this right now, but they will tell you that I am going to try to say it in the most loving way, but I am not going to lie. I'm not going to lie to you. I'm going to tell you when you're wrong. And I've had friends be mad at me for a few days. And then they come back and be like, yeah, I was just mad, but you was right.
I just told y'all last week that me and my best friend of 21 years had it. We had a nice little break. Cause she was like, damn, why you have to say it? But you done known me since I was 15. I ain't changed since I was 15. Damn, why you acting brand new like you ain't know I was gonna say it like that? Now, to be fair, did she necessarily need it that way at that time? No. But the bottom line is that you done known me since I was 15.
Come on, son. I was gonna say, you knew how.
Because regardless of how I said it, tell me what lie I told you.
Zero, none. No lies told.
Sometimes, ladies, we need to humble ourselves. And this ain't me, you know, throwing shots. Well, this ain't me doing that. This is me being just honest. Sometimes, ladies, when your people tell you stuff about you, whether it be about your man, whether it be about your children around that nigga, hello, because it's too many babies coming up missing dad. It's too much stuff going on with these men's y'all got in y'all cheering lives.
And you know how I feel about that. So we don't have a whole conversation.
You know how I feel about it.
I know how you feel about that. I know how you feel about that.
And like, it's too, like, come on.
Definitely talk about that. But you have to be willing to
Hear that. Like, if your sister and everybody in your life, whether they single, whether they married, engaged, baby daddy, situationship, they've been together 17 years and they already know what it is. Whatever your people situation is, if your people coming to you telling you some real shit, you need to listen.
Gotta listen.
And listen, like, listen with your heart. Don't listen with your feelings, G. Because your people not going to hurt your feelings. And if they do, they only did it. They did it passively. Because the direct message is, you out here fucking up. The direct message is, you need to get back on that. The direct message is, you need to keep that little girl away from that nigga. The direct message is, you need to get rid of that nigga. Or on the opposite end, you need to be better to that nigga. Like, you need to watch your attitude. You need to watch your tone when you speak to people. You need to clean up your energy so you can attract with all of that. You need to stop being so, like, when your people tell you stuff, ladies, stop being so in your ego or that toxic femininity that you can't hear it. You ain't perfect. Because I didn't have people pull me to the side and tell me my business. Do you hear me? Tell me all of my business.
You needed it. We all need it sometimes.
And I ain't talking about no tarot reader neither. I'm talking, and I rocks with all of them. And they didn't read me down, dude. Down. Tarot read. These niggas don't know me, and these cards was like, bitch, you fucking up and shutting up.
Get it together.
But when your people telling you something, one, you do have to consider the source.
Always first.
But
first,
G, if your mama telling you,
consider the source.
But G, if your mama telling you, G, if your sister telling you, if your best friends of 20, 20, 30, 40, 45 years is telling you, come on, man. Humble yourself, sis. Because somebody in there is telling you right. Everybody's not hating on you. And you're not so perfect, or you're not so above reproach that somebody can't yank your chain. Iron sharpens iron. If I fuck with you, I'm going to let you know what it is.
And let's be real, because I don't want you around me if you can't iron sharpen me.
Period.
Sharpen iron. If you're not here to enhance me, then we need not even share the same space. So, it may hurt your feelings hearing that, but I'm not trying to hurt your feelings. I'm trying to make you aware. And that's very different. There are some people that's going to tell you some stuff because they're trying to cut you down. But that's why it's important.
Not my job. Not my place.
A source. If you have to look at somebody close to you and question if that's the place that they're approaching you from, if it's a place of tearing you down, then you need to reevaluate why you got that person in your corner. Because everybody close to you should be there for your benefit. And if you have questions about that, then you need to do something about that.
Period.
Point blank and period. And understand that you need to own your shit. We all do. We all need to own our shit. And every time that you don't, and you put it off on men, and you put it off on your dad, and you put it off on all of these other forces, and not come to the realization of where you need to own your shit, that is toxic femininity.
Because what did your mama look like in your household? What did your grandma look like? What was they dating like? like life? Did they teach you anything about that? Did they teach you anything about feminine energy at all? I'm not a proponent of that. I grew up in a house full of males, so I don't know nothing about it. But that also stems to the root of a lot of my toxic femininity. I operate primarily in my masculine energy because that was my environment for 15 fucking years. That's what I'm comfortable with. I know how to dress like a girl because that's, I had to learn that. And I'm still through trial and error, I'm having to learn that. When your man's and them come, when your partner come to you and tell you, I need you to soften that up a little bit, you might want to listen. And I was the one who wasn't until some feminine women came to me and was like, as beautiful as you are, don't no nigga want you dressing like no nigga.
And they don't want you walking around treating them like they obsolete either.
Or treating them like you one of they niggas, like one of they homies. Like, nah, that's not gonna rock. Not in all, under all circumstances. And I, listen, y'all know me. I am who I am. You either gonna take it or you gonna fuck off. But when my partner comes to me and tells me, listen, I love you as you are, but I need you for my, can you?
Scale it back. I've had to have one of those conversations myself, and I done been with this man. I don't want to say how long. He took all my...
And it's been 6 years for me, so... And it's not... And he wasn't hating. It's not that he was trying to change me. Listen, I've been here for 6 years, so I ain't got on his nerves enough for him to say, bitch, I can't. Okay? Clearly, I'm still around for a reason, and because the price is good. It ain't just that. But the bottom line is he had some grievances with some things that I was either doing or some ways that I was operating that was just not working for him. And he was like, listen, I love you down. I need you. I need this.
And I just want to say that that's probably one of the things that I really had to kind of learn, coming from a strong mother who it ain't too much she can't do and she ain't gonna do. Fortunately, I had two males in my life to kind of try and keep me softened up because they were concerned like, oh, you go out there with the, you know, this whole I am woman with everything, you know, it's gonna be hard for a man to relate to you. And I struggled at one point like, well, why do I have to damn myself? Why do I have to be dumb?
Oh, yeah, I still struggle with that.
You know, and trying to, and I had to learn, like, no, that's not the same thing. Unless he telling me don't have a mind, I can't speak unless being spoken
right.
to.
Right.
You know, all your place is in the kitchen, barefoot and pregnant and nothing else. Then he's not trying to belittle me.
Yo, my dad told me when I was, like, 26, and I'll never forget it. He was like, I feel sorry for the guy who marries you. I almost said bitch, but y'all know, if y'all know who my daddy is and how big that was never going to ever, not never. I wasn't going to live to see 27. But he was like, nah, he was like, I'm scared. He was like, no, I'm not trying to say like you'll never get married. I truly do believe that you will. But I know for a fact that whoever he is has to have nerves of steel and a spine of Kevlar because you are extremely strong. And when he says strong, I'm quite sure he was saying in the most general sense, not specifying certain characteristics, because I just am. And because of circumstance, and he understood all of them. He was like, you're a very strong woman. Mm-hmm. And if he is not stronger than you, you will run over him. Mm. And that is not going to work for you.
Telling my business. I done had
to. So he is either going to have to be as strong as you or stronger, or that shit is not going to work. He's going to have to be the one that's going to be able to tell you to shut the fuck up and you do it. Anybody else, I feel sorry for him because you're going to run him right over. And I was like, my nigga, what the fuck you trying to say? But he ain't lying because my partner now, I'm, you know, When he right there, I'll be quiet. But when he leave, I'll be talking again. That's no shade. That's not, and I don't feel like that's belittling myself. It's my father told the truth. And it, to be fair, considering the fact that I moved from one state to another at age 9 and had to adjust to that And then I had to move from Inglewood to Bellwood, transfer to another school in the middle of my freshman year. I had to adjust to that. I had a whole bunch of other stuff, plus the cancer thing, plus, like, I've been through a lot of shit. My dad knows that. He's been there through all of it.
Struggle can make us very arrogant as women.
I mean, I would like to say that I'm just, you know, very aware of my talents.
I said what I said. I said what I said. Struggle can make us very arrogant as women.
I'll own that. That's fine. You can't tell me shit.
If we've had to go through some things, if we've had to just get through, bear through it, and still endure and come out and look, make it look easy. We start.
Bro, you can't say, right. You can't tell me nothing.
You can't tell me nothing. You
can't talk to me, bro.
You can't be me. You can't be me. I did this, and this. And that's something that, as I said earlier, when I had to have my baby come to me and kind of check me, you know, I was just like, well, what do you mean? Like, let's talk about this. What do you mean? I'm you feel sorry for me? That's pretty strong. Do you know what you're saying? Like,
right.
Like, oh my goodness, like, let's explore this. But that made me realize is that while I'm thinking I'm running around and I'm this whole thing to look up to, like, her perspective was so different. It was like, don't you get tired? Like, why you always want to do some things you just always put on yourself, and you just shouldn't, you know, put those things on yourself. And you just, you know, but there was some other things that maybe contributed to that. However, she was right. She was right. And sometimes, because we just get so used to, well, if it ain't gonna be done the right way unless I do it, sometimes you're killing yourself. And we get so arrogant. We just take that struggle and that ability to do all of these things and still stand, even though we be broken as hell.
Or it's called self-sabotage. Because you'll turn around and claim you're a strong woman, but then turn around and complain about having to be a strong woman.
Complain about it.
And then double back and turn around and complain about the help that you ain't getting, that you ain't asked for. Who am I talking to? Stop playing with me.
Talking to somebody.
I don't have Steinway on my forehead, so stop trying to play me.
I'm talking to somebody.
And stop trying to play yourself.
Sometimes we do that, and we just need to be honest with ourselves and stop being so worried about being ran over. Stop being so worried about being weak. Sometimes I just want to just not be strong. And it's okay to not be strong. It's okay to not be okay. And you need to stop lying to yourself and telling yourself that with your Black woman superhero syndrome that you always got to be okay. We lied to you, sis. No, you don't.
Man, I'm cramping right now. I ain't for it. I'm cramping right now. I feel like the little demons from the movie Ghost is coming to snatch my body down to hell with Willie from Prospect Place and Fitz, okay? I am not in the mood. Today is not the best day for me. But it took me a long time to get to a space where I could acknowledge that I'm not having a good day.
You got to be able to say it. Because then you can't get mad back to that conversation about being inhuman. You can't get mad when people treat you like that, when they forget that you're a human being. If you operating like that, like you are impervious to everything, like you're invincible, nothing penetrates you, and then you can't be mad that people treat you that way. So sometimes you still need to show that softness and that humanity in you to remind people it don't make you weak. It doesn't give people the right.
I'm still learning that last line she said, but okay, fine. She said what she said.
I said what I said. I said what I said, and I'm speaking from experience, because being strong all the damn time is hard, and I'm tired. I am tired of being that, seeing that, and teaching that that's what my baby has to do. So when she...
Well, that's what your son has to put up with, or tolerate, rather.
From who? From me?
No, from another woman when he, you know...
We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about that, because that's super important too. Like, I mean, when I tell you that I didn't realize at what level I was functioning until my babies got to a point where they were starting to process things and they could share with me. And it was truly a mirror. It was like one of the hardest reflections I've ever had to look into. But now I look forward to having those conversations with them because I'm learning from them. They're keeping me in check too. And they're keeping me aware on where I need to do better and how I need to readjust while they still little, because I don't want them to go out and encounter those things. They have to understand what's healthy and what's not, but how they gonna do that
if they aren't seeing it in me?
If they're not seeing it in their dad, if they're not seeing it in between us, they gonna go and have the same type of struggles. We always trying to prevent our girls from repeating our mistakes. Well, baby, the best way you do that is admitting that you made them, forgiving yourself for making them, and then healing from them. Because that fear is what breaks them.
Hmm.
That fear of them repeating some of your mess ups is what breaks them. Like, I'm speaking from a place of understanding. Like, I'm telling you what I know. Because it took for me to realize that I'm operating in my own trauma and I'm so afraid it's going to happen to my baby and I'm breaking her in the process. I'm pretty much fulfilling the prophecy anyway. You got to heal within. You got to forgive yourself. You got to say, you know what? It hurt me. I'm hurt. I'm not okay. And I need to fix it. And then you got to do your work. I see. Did I speak to you?
To me? I told you I'm in therapy for a reason. So,
but it's the truth. We got to stop doing this to ourselves. And we got to stop doing it to our kids. And allow yourself to be open enough to hear that growth. Because that's the only way we going to break some of these curses. If you so got all these walls up and you Bruce Lee-ing and all of this stuff dodging like you on the Matrix from hearing the truth, then your children's children, and your children's children's children are going to repeat all of that.
Well, before you even get in a space where you're willing to acknowledge a trusted individual telling you the truth, you need to get comfortable with telling yourself the truth and being okay with that. If your truth is telling you that it's something that your child's behavior has changed because something didn't happen to them, I'm gonna need you to go lean into that truth, baby. Because we got too many kids walking around here with sexual trauma because y'all acting like, well, she just acting out. Out of nowhere, fuck out of here, G. When your spirit telling you something wrong with your baby, I'm gonna need you to lean into that.
That's why.
When your spirit telling you, I don't know about it. I don't know about moving into that house with that. I'm gonna need you to lean into that, even if you desperate for somewhere to stay. If your spirit tell you don't move on that block, don't move on that block. If your spirit tell you don't be with that nigga, you need to leave him alone. Stop giving him 15 chances and leave that nigga alone. If your spirit tell you I probably need to go to this junior college instead of jumping to this big university, take your ass to Malcolm X, G.
That's it.
Go to Malcolm X.
And as a graduate of community college, I am an advocate for going to community college.
And as an individual who went to Malcolm X in between between Illinois State and Fisk University, hey man, they took my credits and they took my money.
And listen, and it was cheaper. I was mad when my mom was like, oh, you ain't going nowhere. It's like all my friends is packing up.
Child, you weren't finna send me to Triton North, I'll tell you that though. Sorry about that.
Look.
I was going to Proviso North, honey.
I had some of the best years. Once people realized I wasn't stuck up in me, I had some of the best years of my life at Triton.
But the bottom line is, ladies, some of that toxic femininity stems from you knowing and you ignoring your own. And sometimes you need to go and get in the mirror and face your own. You still mad because of some whatever trauma that happened to you as a kid. You still mad because that man that you wanted don't want you no more. You still mad that man that you wanted never did want you. Or you still mad because whatever reason you gave birth to a kid and he ain't helping with this one, but he helping with them. Hey, man. Deal with it. Get in the mirror and say, yeah, I'm mad. And it's okay to be mad. You justified in it. Now, staying mad is a whole other reason. Staying mad is why your ass is sitting around toxic, burling, and stank right now.
And then who you punishing? If you got kids and you operating underneath that,
who they can see that.
They can see that. The best thing you can do for that baby is let that baby see for themselves. And I promise you, they are going to see it. They're going to know. You don't have to try and badmouth, bro. You don't have to try.
You ain't got to keep the baby from the father if he's a good father. And he's there and active, but they got a stepmama and it ain't you, the real mama. Stop doing that, ladies. Stop doing that, ladies.
As long as she is a good person and your kids are safe, don't be mad at her.
But let's just take her off the table because this ain't about her. Stop keeping them kids from their daddy. If he's active and he's a good daddy, he don't want you no more. Let it go.
Let it go. Let it go.
Stop it. I'm sorry. Listen, that is a very triggering subject for me, not because that's what I experienced at all, but I get so tired of seeing our women be so angry at that nigga that you letting your child not see his father because of whatever reason, or you creating all of these 15 different stipulations to when and how he can see his kid, when you can just arrange, pick up and drop off to grandma and go about your motherfucking business and your goddamn day. Or you can be an adult and learn how to co-parent and get out your feelings. Now, I don't know anything about that. But what I will say is this, before anybody get in this thing and tell me, well, you're not a mother because so you don't understand, the same way y'all got in this thing last week and said, wait till you get married. Let me explain something to y'all. Stop saying that to people. Stop it. And I'm no. Stop. Let me tell you why. Because while I might not be a baby mama and while I might be a parent, guess what the fuck I was? I was the kid. And I was a kid between two parents. And I love my parents. I love them dearly and I'm not going to drag them publicly nor privately. But what I will say is this. I don't know about co-parenting as a parent. What I do know is the lack of co-parenting, healthy co-parenting that happened between my parents is the root of a lot of my toxic femininity. Because I grew up wanting to tell them, what the fuck is wrong with y'all, G? Don't nobody give a fuck about y'all feelings. Hello, am I not standing here?
Here's the thing though, sis, and I gotta correct you on this. And I know that you all are watching us, we done went over the hour, but this is juicy and we gonna cut it short soon. But I need to tell you this because, well, I wholeheartedly agree 100% with what you're talking about. And I'm not going to go into detail of why exactly I understand exactly what you're saying and how important it is. I'm also someone that also knows how sometimes, like we were just telling people to go with your intuition. If you got real concerns, I am in no way telling you send your child anyway. If you have genuine concerns,
correct.
There's a difference in having your ego hurt and having your pride hurt. And you being heartbroken because you didn't get your family. Because most women ain't operating out here on having kids, not wanting the family structure. There may be some, but the average woman wants to have that family. They want to have that dad in the life.
And that's fair. And it's based in trauma because their mom and daddy wasn't there. They trying to.
And sometimes it's just because if you understand and appreciate what that does, as somebody that is married to my children's father, I know what that feels like to them. I know how that feels for them. And I also know firsthanded why they love it, why they look to it.
Yeah.
So it's okay that you wanted to be with him. It's okay.
Nothing wrong with that. And I'm sure that was the intention for y'all walking in the door sometimes.
But if you not together because you just wasn't good together, that's not a good reason to keep that man from and your child from having the proper love of their father. So I agree with you wholeheartedly on that. But also, I'm going to say as someone that is a sexual assault advocate, that is a DV advocate, that has worked in trauma for the last 8 years of my life, if you feel that your child is genuinely unsafe, then you go with that intuition. You don't ignore that. But that's the only reason when it is non-toxic to keep your child from an environment.
Period. Or if there's some abuse, like physical abuse. If you sent your baby to that man's house and they came back with a bruise that was not indicative of them playing on the monkey bars, then you be concerned and you start asking questions and start restricting visitation until otherwise.
Because things are really happening to kids. So I don't want to oversight that.
At all.
Also, sis, I love you. You know I love you from my toes to my hair follicles. Okay? But baby, until you experience some things, everything you thought about that thing before you experience it is going to change. I've been with this man, okay? I met Robert in 2003, okay? We have been involved with each other since 2003, and we only married in 2012. And honey, all that time before we got married still did not properly prepare me for the matrimony, the sanction of marriage. It is not the same. And everything that I thought that I was going to be going in, everything that I thought it was going to be going in, and I can't even say that because I had a real good understanding of what I wanted and what I thought it should be. But I'm going to tell you, honey, a lot of my views on a lot of things have changed in experiencing it. So when we are saying, like, it's not to shade when we say, you know, you're not married. It's not to shade. It's not the shade to say that, or to say if someone, not everyone's saying that, like, you're not a parent, to diminish your opinion. But that's just like saying, like, I ain't never did no surgery on nobody. I can't begin to go and tell a surgeon what I feel like he did wrong in the operating room. I don't got no medical degree.
Now,
so until you're actually in the position, you can't really speak for it from a point of clarity because you have not experienced that.
True. However, comma, what we not going to do as adults is act like we don't remember what that felt like watching, experiencing, feeling that as a kid. Now, I'm not saying that my lack of experience or it leans that my opinion should be listened to. That's not what I'm saying at all. What I am saying is let's not disregard people's opinions and experiences because they don't look like that. Because for me, what it looks like, what it reads like sometimes is this. No, I don't know what it looks like to co-parent because I've never had to do it. But at what point do co-parents sit down and stop and think, damn, is this arguing? Can they hear us? Can they see us? Do they not? Because let's be clear. The one thing I do know, with or without being a parent from a clinical perspective, y'all kids not as dumb as y'all trying to make them be.
Facts.
They hear, they see, they experience everything. And I'm not just talking from my own triggers, okay? I'm talking from what I have seen working with children. They see and hear every goddamn thing you do, the same way you saw and heard every raggedy ass goddamn thing your mama, daddy, grandma, grandpa, uncle, auntie, y'all saw all of that. So somehow or another in your memory, it don't trigger you to realize that if you weren't comfortable with seeing that, watching that, experiencing that, your kid ain't gonna be okay with that either. Like, at what point, and I'm asking, this is a genuine question. At what point do you stop as an adult or as a parent, male or female, and consider your child and how they feel, not how you feel, how they feel and how you feel is affecting them?
So I'm gonna address that really quickly and then we gonna close because I swear I could go all night about some of this stuff.
And again, I'm just asking because this is a genuine question.
I hear you. So one of the first things that you have to do as a parent, I know that I've had to do this as a parent, is stop using adulticism. I don't know if you guys know what adulticism is.
You see me looking confused.
Okay. Adulticism is, it falls under the umbrella of oppression. So what we do as adults and what we experience as kids, especially, and we're, again, this is a generational curse. So I'm going to have a show. We're going to talk about adulticism in depth, because I feel like a lot of people, just like you kind of was like, oh, what's that? A lot of people don't know what that is. So what happens in adulticism is pretty much that we treat kids like they don't know anything.
Ooh, and it annoys the fuck. It burns me.
We oppress them. And I know people are going to be like, how you oppress a kid? You know,
can we talk about it? Because we do.
We absolutely positively oppress children. And we were oppressed as children. If you ever heard that kids are meant to be seen and not heard.
All my damn life.
If you ever heard or ever were told that you a kid, you don't got nothing to worry about. What are you upset about? Why are you in your feelings? Why are you upset? You got a good life. Everything is done for you. What are you worried about? What are you pained about? That's all oppression and that's all adulticism. And part of that is thinking that when you in that made of their father or their, you know, the other parent are not getting along, or it's toxic in between you, that it's not hurting your kid, that they don't know this or they don't know that, or they too they young can't feel. To understand this and that and why I do like this and why I do like that. And what happens is you diminish them and they start to internalize that, and you oppress them early. And they struggle with that. And I really want to talk about this in depth, because this is very much something that is a generational curse, and something that I especially have pride myself on as a parent and not doing. My kids can talk to me and say whatever. Okay?
Can you say whatever one more time? Because a lot of y'all out here be telling y'all kids you think and be shaming them to the point where they feel like they can't come to you, and they want to because you're their mother. And you're their safe space.
I make myself available for that, because it's super important that, one, that's how they learn to communicate and articulate emotion. So if I shut them down before they even understand, like, that's what I'm doing. We wonder why we have people running around here that can't communicate. When you like, oh, this person can't communicate, we can't have a conversation without argument. Or if I say something, if it's adverse to what that person means or feels, they think I'm trying to argue. That's where this all stems from.
Or let's talk about when your child comes to you and tell you their stomach is hurting, you just shoot him off. Like, girl, you just being dramatic. When they probably get bullied at school and they have psychosomatically manifested a stomach ache because they have anxiety.
That is the
issue. And they don't know how to communicate. But because you're not paying attention, and you think because they a kid, they can't have emotion, they can't have feelings. And again, this is not me talking from my trigger. This is me talking from what I've seen as a clinician.
Well, listen, God damn it. This is me talking from being a mother.
Okay. Well, and that's fair, because you would know more directly.
I'm validating you in the fact of that what you're saying is absolutely right.
It's like y'all really be brushing y'all kids' feelings off for something as simple as a tummy ache when that has manifested from some stuff that's happening in real life. Or you brushing your kids off when they got dreams and aspirations that might sound silly now, but might turn into something big. Like, you just brushing it off because, well, you just a kid, you'll change your mind later. Damn, can they just have that moment right now?
And it's okay if at 8 o'clock, you know, Kyron taught me 8 o'clock, 8 years old. Kyron told me when he was 4, he wanted to grow up and be a cookie taster.
Hey, food tasters make bread, though. I ain't mad at him.
And I was like, okay, all right. He's four. What would be upset about that for? Because he's not the typical kid that said, I want to be a fireman or a police officer or a doctor. Okay, baby, what cookies do you want to take?
Hello. Where like, you want to work at? Nestle? I bet you they got some fire chocolate chips. You know what I mean?
We really got to stop treating our kids that way and stop, like, adultifying them and expecting for them to think on the level. It's such a contradiction. It's like, at one point you want them to be so much more mature beyond their years with stuff, but then on the same note you tell them they don't know shit.
And let's be clear, you only want them to be mature beyond their years because of the toxicity based on your trauma. Because your mama had you raising your brothers and sisters when you was 14 and they was 13, 12, 11, 9, 4, 3, and 6 months. All children she had by choice, but you have had to raise by default. So because you had to grow up fast, you got to implant that in your baby. Well, you got to know this. Well, you got to know that. Why? You didn't have to know it. You had to know it because that's just the circumstance.
Simple. I'll do you one more simple sense. Just because you ain't got no patience. You want them to be beyond their years because you don't have no patience.
Can you dive into that, please?
I'm gonna try to make this quick because
no, for real. I can tell by the lack of comments this week that we might be triggering some folks, but it's okay. We love y'all.
It's okay. I'm trying to look down at the whole comments and you know, this is stuff that I really want to address, and we're gonna have to come back to, like, one of the shows is going to be simply on adulticism, and Noriah is going to join us on that show, and she's going to talk about her perspective as a kid, because I feel like that's super important. And one of the things that, you know, if I didn't listen to my child, I don't know where my baby would be. And we truly have to stop as parents, because we don't have no patience, because we ain't dealt with our trauma, because it makes us feel uncomfortable. I'm gonna tell you something as a parent, that if you think that you fail it or something comes up where it's a reflection on something you're falling short in as a parent, the shit hurts. It cuts so deep. It cuts so deep. But get out your feelings and attend to your child.
Or if every time you look at that baby, you see the father, because genetics were just that strong. And every time you look at that kid, you feel whatever resentment towards the father because that baby had that face. Hey man, stop sending that energy towards that kid.
Stop sending it.
Here's the thing. My parents as co-parents didn't have the healthiest relationship. But what I will say about my mama is this. Not now, another one time, did my mother ever make me feel like she hated my father, or make me feel like she hated me. Because I have his whole entire face. When I say his whole face, baby, the only thing I'm missing is the mustache. Do you hear me?
Yeah.
My mother never, not one time, made me feel like I was, you know, just this horrible person. You just like your goddamn daddy. Y'all stop doing that to y'all kids, G. Because here's the thing. Number one, if they just like their father, that's just by default, because genetics just kind of rule the day. Number two, you picked his goddamn daddy. Point blank, period, bottom line, no equivocations about it. That nigga might not be shit, and he might just like him. You might look at that baby and he might emulate everything about his daddy. Guess what? That's genetics and choice. You picked him. You chose him. Let's deal with that word, ladies, because a lot of that is also the root of our toxic femininity. A lot of us don't want to acknowledge the bad choices.
Yes, indeed.
That we make, because I'm telling you now, everything in this life, even from your trauma, even with how you react to your trauma, everything in your life is about a choice. Everything. So when you're looking at these kids and you're mad at them, or you're looking at these kids and you're mad at the father that you created them with, hey man, you need to look in the mirror and be mad at yourself twice as much, because you chose them, period. Unless you just that fertile, unless the condom broke, unless you just that fertile in birth control, this ain't your thing. Baby, you chose the father. And not only that, the extension of that, you chose to have that child. Everything is a choice. Sometimes you gotta face it.
Sometimes you gotta tell yourself the truth. And if you don't walk away from anything tonight, from anything else tonight, and all the things and all the hard stuff we done said, and you probably might not come back next week, but we want you to. We love y'all.
Please do, because we about to get them in, and it's probably the only reason they would come back, because we about to tag them in.
And I'm actually hoping to have some men talk about it on the
show. Do.
So it's not like we just come in, you know, because I try to operate from a space of humility. I am not a man. I'm not a man, and I really
want I wish I was sometime, because this being a woman is hard, honey. It's my nerve.
I'm sorry. So as I was saying, I know I'm me.
I'm not mad. I appreciate the attempt, honey.
Everybody can't sing like you though.
Let's not act like that's a gift, honey. Sometimes it's cursed too.
Okay, I guess. No, I guess I'm not on you. I validate you and how you feel. Like, I'm gonna throw that in there. I validate your feelings.
Appreciate it.
And accept how you feel. Okay.
Thank you.
Mama, I'm here and I understand.
Thank you.
You're welcome, dear. Yes, indeed. But we're going to end it on that note. We dropped a whole lot of heavy stuff. I see it. Yolanda was like, whoo, y'all walking heavy. We sorry, but we not sorry.
No, we not. No, we not.
We really needed to address some of these issues because they are so deep rooted in our culture. And if we keep talking about, like, everybody's talking about the financial aspect and want reparations and want all of this, but our souls are poor. We got to, our integrity is questionable. We got to fix it. We can't just expect like all of this is going to get us to a better space if we're not addressing the deep rooted issues. So we had to address them, but know that everything we said is out of love.
Everything and out of experience.
Out of experience.
Absolutely. Because listen, I am a very passionate person when it comes to certain subjects. The reason why is because I'm speaking out of experience. Mm-hmm. I'm not gonna drag no woman on this timeline without knowing and being very aware of the fact that my edges are thin from having dragged my own goddamn self on several occasions. Please do not ever think for one second that whatever I said tonight was me saying you did, you said, you ain't, you need to. On one hand, it was, but on the other hand, it's because that's what I had to get in the mirror and say to my own damn self.
I have daily reflections. Daily. I reflect every night on what things I want to do better at, what things I feel short on. I reflect daily.
Man.
Okay? Every single day, I look at me right in the mirror and I have a talk with myself. Because that's what we should be doing. That's what we need to be doing. So I hope this conversation today has helped some of you. I hope that some of you don't hate our guts. I hope some of you will return again next week. I hope that you understand that this is all coming from a place of love and just concern, and that we just want to see us win and we want to see us do better.
So with that, ladies, we're going to take our foot off y'all neck tonight. We're gonna give it a little rest. We're gonna rest our ankles, rotate them a little bit. Cause next week, fellas,
you on that.
You about to get on that ass. Foot's gonna be on y'all neck. Now let's be clear. This isn't a drag session, ladies. Let me say it again. Because what I do appreciate about this comment section is there were not a lot of men on here, you know, amening and high-fiving and yeah, y'all ain't, this is not that, that's not what this conversation was ever going to be about.
And to be quite honest, I believe we had a man that said that men do a lot of the same things that we talked about today.
So, ladies,
go back in those comments and review that comment, but thank you for whomever.
So, ladies, let's go ahead and put this disclaimer out right now. While this comment section had some comments, it's a little light this week compared to what it has been in the last couple of weeks. And I understand why, because sometimes we don't like looking at our stuff, and I get it. That said, please tread very lightly next week when we speak on toxic masculinity, because what I have found is even in just posting on social media, I personally have posted about toxic masculinity and got myriads of responses and hundreds of likes and loves. Whenever I mention toxic femininity, baby, that comment section and them likes some light.
It'd be like crazy.
So let's not turn next week into, I hate my baby daddy, my ex-husband ain't, my daddy. Let's not do that. But fellas, the same way we grabbed the ladies by their edges this week, we gonna grab y'all by them edges next. What edges, whatever toupee, whatever juices and berries, whatever two-tone fade.
Oh, I ask you every week to behave.
Be
week you just can't do right. I just
we gonna get you next week. We love you, but we gonna get you next week, okay?
So okay. We hope y'all show up. Thank y'all for listening tonight. Before we head out, I want to remind everybody to like our Facebook page, Oh We Gonna Talk. Also,
thumbs up.
Follow us on Twitter, @O_WeGonTalk. And tell us what you think. Tell us if there is something that's deep in your soul about a generational curse. Please email us at owegontalk@gmail.com. Okay. And our business of the week goes out to my boo. I don't know if she was able to watch today because she's such a hard worker. My love, Miss Makila Warren, who is the she is the owner of her business. She's a gym. And it's a one-stop shop for all your needs. They have custom shoes, shirts, handmade masks, rolling trays, and oh yeah, bling is everything.
So, hold on, pause. You said rolling trays? Where's that? I need that website.
I knew I had you at rolling trays. Help me, Lord. It's legal. It's legal.
Finally, the herbs come around.
So look on our page. I'm going to have, I'm going to have She's a Gym on the Oh We Gonna Talk page, so you
okay. I go look
her and shop. She's also on Facebook, so you know, I mean, she got it all and she blinks everything. And if you want your business to be our featured business of the week, please
holler at us,
email us, or you can direct message us through our Facebook page or whomever. We appreciate you guys for coming out tonight, for hanging with us, because we went long tonight.
We went real heavy and we get it. But we had to, y'all.
We had to. And we thank y'all for being here, for all the love and support. And we hope to see y'all next Tuesday at 8 p.m. We're going to be on time. We're going to keep the street going.
Yes, we are.
We're going to be on time, 8 o'clock. Sometimes we're a little bit early, but we hope to see y'all then. We love y'all. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Do your work. Heal. And we're going to keep breaking these curses. Good night,
y'all. Good night.